Hello, everybody. Welcome to the History Value Podcast with your host, Jacob Berman. Today, I am privileged to introduce Professor James Charlesworth. Professor James Charlesworth was the Princeton Theological Seminary's George L. Collord Professor of the New Testament Language and Literature. He specializes in the Apocrypha and Pseudepigrapha of the Old and New Testaments, the Dead Sea Scrolls, Josephus, Jesus Research, and the Gospel of John. As director of the seminary's Dead Sea Scrolls project, he has worked on the Qumran Scrolls to make available, in cooperation with more than 50 international specialists, an accurate text with apparatus, criticus, an English translation, and an introduction. He has excavated at Migdal, Bethsaida, Nazareth, Jerusalem, Khirbet Beza, Qumran, and elsewhere. Charlesworth has taught at Duke University, Hebrew University, and the Albright Institute, both in Jerusalem, and the University of Tübingen. He has served as Distinguished Visiting Professor at Naples University and McCarthy Professor of the Pontificia Università Gregoriana in Rome. He has two honorary doctorates, honors from more than 18 countries, and numerous medals, including the medal from Brancoveanu Monastery and Sâmbãta de Sus, the Distinguished Achievement Citation from Ohio Wesleyan University, the Comenius Medal from Charles University, Prague, and the Pentecost Medal, presented by His Beatitude, the Greek Orthodox Patriarch of Jerusalem, Theophilus III. An ordained minister in the United Methodist Church, he serves as advisor to the denomination World Missionary Council and preaches and lectures globally. He has published 95 books and edited 400. All right, then. Welcome, Professor Charlesworth, to the History Value Podcast. Thank you for joining me today. I have many questions prepared for you, as you know. And I would like to start off with, because we talked about this in private correspondence, archaeological evidence for the existence of Solomon and David in the historical record. You said that there's been recent excavations in Israel. You just recently returned from Israel to Princeton. Could you discuss that, please?
Let me thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak to all the people that follow you, Jews, atheists, Christians, Roman Catholics, people who are searching for answers. That's actually me. Although I'm a Methodist minister, I began my career asking questions, and I think that's what makes people excited and committed. Now, you asked a question about the graves of Solomon and David. We have found them in Jerusalem and within the walls, and that is problematic because kings are not buried within the walls of a city. Now, obviously, David was the first king, and this is long before any kind of rules are made. So he is buried near the wall, and I have marvelous pictures, and I do give lectures on it, but it's really impressive. Now, it was robbed by the Romans. The Romans were fighting the Jews. I turned off all my phones, but I can't get that one off. I'm sorry.
All good.
There was a horrible war, and the Jerusalem area between 67, really 69 and 70, first century, everything that was important was destroyed. So they would tear down walls, buildings, and they built a wall, a massive wall all around Jerusalem. That's the way the Roman armies did. They built another wall, and there were over 500 people a day crucified on the wall. So that's why all you do is have a remains of a tomb, not a beautiful tomb. It would have been there in Jesus' time. He would have stood and seen it. Okay, now the tomb of Solomon is a little bit to the left, and our work on it suggests that other kings were buried there. But maybe 200 years later, we can never be more precise than that, the subsequent kings were buried in the area outside the walls. So it's very exciting. We do have clear evidence where David and Solomon were buried, and where people are taking now, they are taken to a place of modern Jerusalem. It wasn't the Jerusalem of David and Solomon, and it's a medieval place, and it has the tomb of David on it, but it cannot be the tomb of David.
So there's a separate, if I'm understanding this correctly, there's a separate claimed tomb of David that is distinct from the one you were talking about earlier, that is a medieval, is medieval in origins.
Every archaeologist would agree on that, every historian. Obviously, when people went to Jerusalem about 1300, they didn't know what Jerusalem was like 1300 years earlier, let alone 2300 years earlier. They were not trained. No one was, no matter who you were. And so you have the modern science of archaeology, and it is a science. It is not a theological discipline. We come together and we use every technique you can think of, every advanced method, and there's absolutely no question the tomb of David that is shown to tourists cannot be the tomb of David. It is the expanded part of Jerusalem. As you know, cities grow, so it is far away from where David and Solomon lived.
When exactly were these tombs discovered? How recent?
Oh, that's a very complicated question. They're very hardly anybody knows about them. I lived in Jerusalem since 1968, and I didn't know. I worked with Dan Bahat, who in my judgment is the best archaeologist of Judea and Jerusalem, and he took me there, and he is absolutely certain, as I am. And I became confused because I saw some publications, and they said where David's tomb was, and they got it confused. That's Solomon's tomb. We're talking about the two tombs that have been found and are really unknown to even scholars.
Why is that? Why is it so unknown right now?
Well, I think you can guess what the answer is, as well as the people. It's a little off the beaten track, and I wouldn't take people there now because of the terrible danger in that area. Remember, that is where east meets west. Jesus, you can say, was from the east, and the Romans were from the west. So that's even part of the crisis. During this whole period of Jesus' life, the Persians were attacking from the east, and the Romans were attacking from the west. So I would take you there, but not more than two or three people. It's a bit dangerous. But I think my first point was, it's not where people usually go. I was in Jerusalem for over 50 years. I never had been there.
Back to the historical King David and Solomon, do you think that they existed as described in the Old Testament, or do you think there might have been exaggerating going on? Because people debate on that all the time. What are your thoughts on that exactly?
Well, you have two positions. One, they never existed. And the second position is everything said about them is true. Well, every intelligent person knows those are the opposites, and neither is anywhere likely. We can be certain because of the records and the references by enemies in Egypt and the area, the Mesha Stone, which is in the area. It refers to David and his team and time. And we have found a reference to Dawid, which was his name, which is clearly Melik Dawid, King David. And we found it in Dan, which is very exciting and fairly new. No scholar thinks that they are unhistorical period or unhistorical people. It's a period that we're learning a vast amount now, thanks to archaeology and intensive work. But now the second point is, obviously, if you can use an analogy, you have John Bunyan. Is that his name? You have David Crockett, who was a hero, but the myth about him is so, you know, he killed a bear when he was 3 years old or something. That's not likely. And I think it's John Bunyan, I'd have to look it up, who is purely a myth. But David and Solomon is more like David Crockett. And of course, the big songs, David Crockett, King of the Wild Frontier. Well, that is, and he did die in the Alamo. But back to David, we know he existed. We're even finding a lot of evidence of his time. And you're not going to find something like the name of David, but we did. We did find Dawood, and that is the way his name was pronounced, Dawood, which hardly anybody can pronounce now. Now let's talk about the expansion. Solomon, as time goes on, is considered the wisest man that ever lived. And we have documents that are written by Jews about the time of Jesus, the Testament of Solomon, a little bit after Jesus, that shows how he could control the devils and he had a ring that could kill Satan. These are all myths. And you can imagine as people, and let's not say they're uneducated. Most people are uneducated. You could take a physicist. He's uneducated in archaeology. You could take an archaeologist. He's really not very trained in music. So what does untrained mean? We should never use that term. These were highly intelligent people, and they passed it on, and they really loved David. And all the Psalms are attributed to him. But now the critical scholars are working very hard to try to find out which ones can really go back to him. So that's an exciting piece of research.
Are there any other archaeological evidence for these Old Testament figures that we don't know about?
Well, if you drive through Jerusalem and around Israel today, you'll find massive highways and superhighways. What was buried under them and never can be found. Around Jerusalem, if you look at it in 1800, there's hardly any buildings nearby. Today, within you get within 5 miles of it, you can't see anything except high rises and buildings. When they were built, what did they destroy? I have found a lot of things that I have never had a chance to talk about. I know where the Essenes were buried. It's near Teddy Stadium, but that doesn't tell people a lot of things unless they're near David's the stadium. It's very, very difficult to talk about the past. Let me tell you, people are saying we have 66 books in the Bible. Well, we have much more other books that are biblical. They didn't make it in the Bible. And the Bible was open until about 200, Common Era. And that's quite something. But let's go back. We didn't know about the Dead Sea Scrolls. It was a Bedouin who found them. He found them in 11 caves. But 99% of them were gone. Little fragments were all that left. And the Bedouin and I spent a lot of time sitting and talking with them. They said we just threw them in the air looking for gold. And then we didn't know what to do. We tried to repair our sandals. Can you imagine sandals repaired with $300,000 worth of a scroll? I can. But smelly scrolls that are 2,000 years old to a Bedouin is worthless. But they found it. Now, my point is, how much was lost forever? But to take the burning of Jerusalem. The burning of Jerusalem in the early fall, September of 70, how many scrolls were in the temple? There were over 20 synagogues. How many scrolls were in them? There were scribes and scholars. How many scrolls were in them? All burned. The whole city was burned down. And it is very hard for me to try to connect get scholars to realize that. I think the laity can grasp it because they haven't spent their life studying what has been preserved. I think we should always ask, what was preserved? Was it an accident? And what has been lost? Obviously, you can't edit what is lost, but you can. What you do edit, you can mention, fortunately, this was lost. There are apocalypses. I know you're going to be talking about that. There are a lot of apocalypses that we know reference to. We don't even have one quote from them.
That's a shame.
Yeah. Well, I would say it's a dedication of scholars who are paid very little, who work 16, 17 hours all of their lives, sacrifice. I wanted to be a trumpet player, and I was trumpet soloist at Duke University, and I wanted to be a basketball player, and I used to play with the varsity, but I got on my knees and said, Lord, I want to be a scholar. I have a lot of questions. So you have to say no to a lot of things and the sacrifices. People could go out and watch movies. I didn't have time to do that. You really had to study, and I'm not bragging, but I had to study Greek and Latin and Hebrew and Aramaic and Syriac and Coptic and hieroglyphics and so forth. And I still don't know Old Church Slavonic, and I don't know Armenian, and I'm not very good in Ethiopic. Now, why is he mentioning? Because when the Romans destroyed and made Rome powerful, all these writings spread around the world into the languages that they're now preserved in. Many writings written in Hebrew or Aramaic, Jesus' language, disappeared and appeared later in Syriac and Greek and other languages. And we're constantly looking for lost manuscripts. I found some in Leningrad. I have found in St. Charles University. I found some in the Vatican. That gets us way off the track, but there are many, many writings that still can be found. Think about the monasteries that have books that are not cataloged.
Yeah. So there's a lot more to be found.
And to be found in the earth, yes. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there are other caves around Qumran. It would be nice if we can get a wealthy man to say, or a wealthy woman or a wealthy group saying, we'd like to help scholars the way that it was being helped in the 20s and 30s. Because now, you see what happened. We had 50 years where basically scholarship proved the Bible inaccurate. Now we're just asking questions and exploring, and we're finding astoundingly how accurate it is. And when we get to Mary Magdalene and Jesus, that will be quite a breakthrough when we talk about synagogues.
Now that you mention it, I do want to get into that. You were saying to me during our phone call conversation that there's been some stuff found on Mary of Magdal. What stuff specifically?
There are three amazing discoveries that I'm happy to announce through you. Migdal is where Mary of Migdal was from. Mary Magdalene is English for Mary of Migdal. Magdalene, Mary Magdalene. So you can hear Migdal. Okay. I excavated there for many summers, not full time, but I can't be in Israel all the time, but I would dig there for three days or a week, and we never found a synagogue. And they have just now found a synagogue. They were putting in a new hotel, and they found, my gosh, look, it's a synagogue. Now, what is exciting about it? A, it's in Migdal, and B, it was covered up in 67. Covered up. There was a war going on, and they wanted to protect it, so they covered it with dirt so that the burning wouldn't get to it, and they never dug it up again. So we have a mosaic that's partly finished, but we can see the benches, and I have sat there. And there's no question, when Jesus came down from Nazareth, he came down this path right into the synagogue. And obviously, we know Jesus goes to a synagogue the first thing. And eventually, a woman named Mary would come and sit beside him and ask him. So when I sat there, I often prayed and said, Lord, help me understand. Give me the wisdom I need to be able to explain this at any time to anyone. How exciting it is. This, no one has sat here since you sat here, because it was covered to protect it and there was a horrible war. Now we found another synagogue. Oh, let's say a block and a half away, farther west. And it's very interesting. It's not as elegant. It doesn't have a mosaic. The first one we found has painted pillars, beautiful pillars. The one that we have just found doesn't even have a roof. Why? it probably had a wooden roof and wooden pillars, and you can understand when you have huge fires. Now let me tell you, we have found the synagogue in Migdal that Jesus sat in which he taught, and which he shared with those. He had by then Peter and Andrew and James and John. So they were sitting near him, and then comes in Mary. And she was a very wealthy woman. The recent Pope is absolutely right. She was not a wicked woman. She had problems. She was very powerful. And they said she had seven demons. That's ancient language for some woman who's different than other women. She was very powerful, probably very independent. We know she's looking for answers. Women are not allowed to ask questions, even today, in many parts of the East. So you can get that. So she's not an evil woman. And she's so fascinated by Jesus. And you know she was, because she was standing at the cross at the end. And she was the one that went to the tomb. So she was absolutely passionate. Wow, can you imagine how exciting it is? Now, Chorazin. Then Matthew and Luke use a source, and they talk about Jesus being in the synagogue in Chorazin. Ah, they're idiots. We found a synagogue. It's 5th century, and below it, there was another 4th century. Well, Jesus can't be there in the 4th century. He was there in the 1st century. Oh, my gosh, what am I telling you? We kept digging and digging. We found under the 4th century synagogue the remains of another synagogue, and it also dates from the time of Jesus.
Wow.
So what are we saying? Are we trying to prove the Bible? No. The Bible needs no one to prove it. Either you accept, in various ways that there is a powerful God, and people have explained what they knew about God, but it was a long time ago. And don't ask them to use our language and the sophistication that everybody has listening to you. So we have found two synagogues that Jesus visited in Migdal and one that he visited in Chorazin. And they're very close. I would say you and I could walk it, let's say 50 minutes. That's nothing. You can get up, have a cup of coffee. They drank coffee, I guess, and walk up the hill and have services in Chorazin. From even Cope, we can go from any one of the little villages down on the Sea of Galilee, Capernaum, for example. That was Jesus's home. He made that his home. We can walk from there, from Chorazin to Capernaum, 1 hour. It's down the hill or up the hill. So, when you go up the hill, let's give us 10 more minutes.
So why haven't other scholars talked about this yet? Even though there's obviously other people that know about this, why hasn't anybody taken photographs or whatever to make this thing public before now?
It's not made public. I'm making it public.
Oh.
I'm working on a book. There, if you wanted to push, there have been some Hebrew articles in some newspapers, but it's not been published.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah, I was just curious about that. Are there other archaeological evidence for other people in the New Testament that we don't know about, too?
Other people in the New Testament?
Yeah, other people.
Can we go to Rome?
Okay.
When I was a professor in Rome, I was taking beneath the St. Peter's. And, of course, it was with a very sophisticated group. And we went down there, and I walked down the 1st century and 2nd century common era streets from about 100, 150, not BC, but in the year of our Lord, 150. And as we went down the streets, there was a grave. And in front of the grave was a beautiful stone, and it said Petrus. And almost everybody knew it was St. Peter. So the Vatican St. Peter's is literally built on the tomb of St. Peter.
That's amazing. Are there others? other ones like that for other people. Like, I've heard one about Paul. I've heard stories about Paul's remains being found, but I when I looked into it, I couldn't find too much information about that. Do you know anything
No,
about that?
no scholar thinks that we have anything from Paul, bone or skin. In fact, if you put together all the bones and skulls claimed to be St. Peter, you would have a multi-headed, multi-armed figure. They can't all go back to Paul. What I can tell you, I've worked on Cyprus, and he was there. And you can see not very much, but you can get the traditions. But remember, it was oral. Fortunately, Paul did write. We have some really marvelous compositions by Paul. He certainly wrote Romans, for example, and it's one of the greatest compositions in history. And it started the Reformation, reading Romans. It started the English Reformation, and it has already always in the churches been one of the great masterpieces. So Paul was a genius. He was also probably a person that wasn't so easy to live with. He was so passionate about Jesus. They couldn't stop him. They would stone him and he would keep coming. He was shipwrecked and he kept coming. And in Ephesus, he fought animals. So he's quite an athlete. And I've written an article when he says, "I have run the course, I have finished the race, and the crown of glory is given for me in heaven." Well, he's not using a metaphor that's fake. It's his own metaphor. He's run races. He fought animals in Ephesus, and obviously he won. So the life of Paul, he was Saul for a while. That is a very important life. Let me talk to Christians. People say Christians are crazy because they believe that that Jesus rose from the dead. Actually, the texts are that God raised Jesus from the dead. It begins as a passive, ergerthe, which means he was raised. Well, who raised him? God. God raised up Jesus, his son. Now, if that's the case, fine. I have no problem. You talk to astronomers, they're talking about Genesis is unbelievable. There's no way they could have known what they explained. There was light. God said, "Let there be light." And that's how the Big Bang began. And so we're finding scientific, if you don't try to prove anything but ask questions, is there a God? How else could you explain what we're seeing? When I started in astrophysics, we knew about seven planets. Now we know about 70,000, maybe 7 million. We don't know how vast our universe are. Who are we? What is the Earth? The sun is not important. It's a little sun. And you and I have been living through a tremendous revolution of thought. So keep asking questions, but that doesn't mean you don't have a commitment. Only a person who has a strong commitment can ask a good question. You take, for example, a boat that doesn't have a rudder. It's not going anywhere, no matter how good the captain is. Get your rudder, ask your questions, and make sure you steer toward what you want to go toward. I hope that is somewhat helpful, but getting back to the resurrection of Jesus, Paul, who is Saul, is on his way to Damascus. He hates the Christians. He calls them infidels. He calls them people who are destroying Judaism. And on the way to Damascus, and he says it in his own words. We have it in the word he wrote. And he appeared to me and he called to me, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" That's all he said. He never said that he saw Jesus. His followers said he saw Jesus, but he was on the way to Damascus and he heard the commission. So there you have a person that hated Jesus, thought the resurrection was a good idea because he was a Pharisee. But these were idiots. These were not trained people like him. They were not brilliant like him. Well, Peter, he had to tell Peter off. But I tend to take Peter's side. Brilliance is not what it's about. It's commitment and following and being truthful to yourself.
So going back to Mary Magdalene, why was she portrayed later on? I know that's the portrayal of her has changed, but why is it for a while she's been viewed that? Why is it for a while? Why has she for a while been viewed as a wicked person, and they said all kinds of bad things about her? What do you think caused that?
Well, it's in Luke when he says that she had seven demons. And it wasn't until the 6th century, that's 600 years later, that they began to say that she had it. Obviously, that she had demons was in the text, but what did that mean? And they interpreted, according to the medieval time, that she was a prostitute. But fortunately, now the Pope has said, no, not at all. That's not what the text means. And everybody I know agrees with it. You can't take your concepts and put it in the Bible and change the Bible. You have to study the Bible and ask, what did it mean to the author and what did it mean to the audience? So when Luke wrote that she had demons, it means she's not an ordinary woman, that she was extraordinary. Of course, we know she was. And I think she was the best disciple Jesus ever had. She was there at the cross, and his blood splattered on her face. And she was the first one to go to the tomb. Now, we would like, when we're in heaven, well, let's walk up and ask Mary Magdalene, why did she go to the tomb? She's not believing that he's alive, because she turns to him and says to a gardener, she thinks this is the gardener. There's nothing wrong with her eyes. What has happened to Jesus? Now we're into preaching and speculation, but she looks at Jesus and she says, Jesus says, Mary. And she says, Rabboni. We have never found that word, Rabboni. I think it means my beloved rabbi. So it may be her special word for him, just like, you know, a lot of people have special words for me. They're nicknames. Rabboni may not be found anywhere except in the text where Mary hears Jesus and says, Rabboni. Now, if you ask me, did she believe? Let me make a point. If you clearly confront the risen Jesus, there's no need for belief. And that's why Jesus cannot come to people the way he did, because there would be no belief. And that's all we can do. We'd be nothing. We have to believe. Oh, people say, you're an idiot, you believe. I will say it's probably the most best aspect of my life. And I know there's another world, and I know there's a powerful force, but we're wanting to stay true to Mary Magdalene. There she is in the garden, and she sees the risen Lord.
That gets me to another question about the tomb. There's a controversial tomb with many ossuaries in it, and it's been claimed for a while that that is the tomb of Jesus, the Talpiot tomb. What are your thoughts on the Talpiot tomb? And then my next question after that will be the James ossuary as well.
Well, you're asking something that is, I've been very much a part of. And I was there with Simca and other wonderful people like the professors at Charlotte, University of North Carolina in Charlotte, James Tabor and others, Gibson. Now, you asked me a question. It gets very complicated. My answer would be, you cannot now say it is not. And that would be my, I don't need to find the tomb of Jesus. And of course, there are Christians who say, if you find bones there, Jesus was never raised. They better go back and read the New Testament. In John, Jesus walks through walls. Now, if he has bones, he can't do that. And he disappears when he's with the disciples. He appears and disappears. He walks all the way from Jerusalem to Emmaus and with Cleopas and his companion. We don't know who the companion is. I have some ideas. And in Eastern Europe, they're absolutely convinced it's Luke, but I don't think that's likely. But he's with him for hours. Cleopas is walking with Jesus for hours. Well, he looks like a human being. He doesn't know it's Jesus. And then after the breaking of bread, he disappears. Well, if he's got bones, he can't walk through doors, as in John. He can't disappear, as in Luke. So if we find the bones of Jesus, Jesus has a God, and you and I and other people have a God that doesn't need to raise the bones. Can you imagine Jesus is the only one in heaven carried around crucified bones? What kind of a God would that be? No. Paul himself said, we have the physical body and we have the spiritual body. We are born with a physical body, he says in Corinthians, and we're raised a spiritual body. Mm. Now, there are many people like you who immediately can understand that in us there is another. Our soul, is our soul physical? Well, then that means it decays with us. So there must be something there. And that gets more and more exciting. Remember, you're asking me questions and I'm doing my best. And your questions are wonderful. Everybody's I'm listening is excited. And I don't know where we're going. And these aren't the questions you were going to ask, which is okay. I can't prepare for them. I've spent my life studying. And I hope they're making sense and not getting too deep. But I would stress that Jesus doesn't go around with a corpse that is bleeding from crucifixion. Who thinks that? I had a professor once said, when we're in heaven, if he doesn't have the marks of crucifixion, I will be upset. And I told him, if he does have them, I think I would be upset. Mm. He doesn't need them.
So who do you think the companion that walked with Jesus is? Probably is.
Well, that's a very interesting question. It could be his wife. They've been together in Jerusalem. An argument in that favor would be you never mention women. Mm. The New Testament is unique because Jesus broke all the customs and included women as equal in every way to men. And if you said, come on, the 12 are all men, you don't know the tradition. The 12 tribes are headed by men. So you can't break the tradition. If you do, you don't have a tradition. At the cross, who is there? Mary, the mother of Cleopas. Mary Magdalene, Mary Jesus' mother, and the texts say other women. He started the greatest woman movement, and women are as equal and maybe superior to us in many ways. Otherwise, we're going to be running around trying to defend ourselves. That's not what life's about, defending living and being joyful and sharing love.
Who do you think the wife of Jesus was? Is it Mary Magdalene?
Well, we're into some very difficult questions. Mm. I've had ministers come to me and said, I'm going to ask you a question. And it depends on how you answer it. Either I'm going to leave the church forever. I don't want to be a minister. Or I'm going to dedicate my life to Christ. Mm-hmm. Was he married? I said, we can't be certain. But he's very, very close to Mary Magdalene. And he's not 30, he's 36 years of age. He starts his ministry about 33 and he dies at 36. If he was born in 6, let's just do that. When Herod the Great heard that there were boys 2 years of age in Bethlehem, he was going to kill them. Well, 2 years of age. So when did he die? 4. So Herod dies in 4, add 2 years, you've got 6. And that would be the year Herod dies. So Jesus was born 6 or 7. Mm. So he died in 30. Some people say different, but most of us think 30. We can't be sure, but you add the 6 and the 30, you get 36. Well, he's pretty old. Most men are already married at 18, and girls are married at 12. So was he married? He was a very devout Jew. I am not saying he was married. We have no text that says he was married, but he was a very, people don't realize what a wonderful human male he was. He was quite an athlete. He was very strong. Remember, Pilate says, has he died already? Pilate saw a strong man. A weak man wouldn't last an hour or two on the cross. He was there at 9 a.m. and died at 3 p.m. That's a long time. Today, great athletes have been hung up like they're on a cross, and they can't make an hour and a half. Super Bowl, NFL players, basketball players, they cannot take it. It's so horrifying. So Jesus is an incredibly strong man. He should be. He spends all night fishing. People say, how do you know that? Haven't you read anything in the New Testament?
Right. Mm-hmm. So that takes me to the James ossuary. I brought that up earlier. There's a lot of controversy about that, as you know. And there's a lot of people out there that say, well, no ossuary says... that no ossuary would state that somebody's a brother or somebody. That doesn't make any sense. And they'll say, and they'll often say that part of the inscription is a forgery, that or a modern forgery or medieval forgery, that the James the son of Joseph, the brother of Jesus, or James the brother of Jesus, the son of Joseph. What are your views on that? And one more question to add to that. There's been scientific analysis done on it that appears to indicate that it came from the Talbiot tomb. What are your thoughts on that as well?
Have you got 4 days?
Well, if you want to do several episodes on that, I would certainly like to.
Yeah, we could do that. You would want to get other people involved, and I'd help you with that. It's a very complex one. They were digging a tomb, and they left it open because Shabbat began. And while the archaeologists and the bulldozers were away or shut down, little kids went in. And the rumor is that they took an ossuary out of there. Now, that is the James ossuary. For years, I have said I don't believe a word of it. I argued that Yeshua bar Yehoseph, Jesus, the son of Joseph, is authentic. Wahui Yaakov, and the brother of James. But the greatest Aramaic scholars, this is Aramaic, in Jerusalem and in the United States said that is all authentic. And I was pushed and I said, it just looks to me a little different, the second hand and the brother of James. And I said, I agree with those. You really don't get the name and the brother of James. I've had to rethink my thoughts. I'll tell you why. They have done a study of the James ossuary, and it is from the tomb. They've done a very intensive study. Well, it's from the tomb. What does that mean? Because the people in the tomb are almost all related to Jesus. And what are we talking about, you know? Jesus, Mary, mother, Mary, and his father, Joseph, however you want to define father. I would think that's another question that I don't want to go into now. Christians are divided on it. But the so-called father of Jesus is Joseph. Well, these are common names. It's like Jack and Jill or Bob and Janet or Alice. So you can't say they're Jesus' father and mother, two common names. But now, the intensive study of the dirt on the James ossuary proves to scientists, and I think to me, it's hard for me to say, well, it looks like I'm getting more and more to think and I have studied the ossuary, I've held it, and I've explored it, and I know it says Jesus, the son of Joseph. Well, there were thousands of people named James, and they were the son of a man named Joseph. The people think, well, Jesus' father was Joseph. That's it. It's a slam dunk. Hmm. Well, come with me and let's start looking at all the ossuaries. Here's James. Here's Joseph. And if you look at Josephus, the names he mentions, you know, Joseph of Arimathea. There you go. It's a very popular name. So that isn't the case. And the brother Ahui, now Ahui is a very odd Aramaic. Mm. And for someone to fake that in modernity is mind-boggling. How would anybody know that? You would have to be the world's best Aramaic specialist. So I had to change my mind. It's not just something that you can do. Ahui, it's not the brother of. It's a very strange form of the brother of. And the brother of Yaakov, James. That's my name, James. So can it be? It looks like it's much more likely than I ever thought. And that gets very interesting because the level of probability begins to rise. Mm-hmm. That we're into something very exciting. But you know, it's going on in our lifetime.
Yeah.
And a lot of the people that are saying it's the James ossuary and we have found the tomb of Jesus, they are very devout Jews who have no interest in Jesus. Mm-hmm. In fact, one of them told me, he's my dear friend, he says, the more I study Jesus, the more I dislike him. And I'm trying to persuade him, the more I study Jesus, the more he's the most awesome, brilliant, and courageous man who ever lived. Imagine standing in front of Pilate and Caiaphas and others, and he didn't open his mouth to defend himself. It goes back to what I was taught as a little boy. Son, don't defend yourself. Your enemies won't believe it. Your friends don't need it. And so there is Jesus, and he doesn't say a thing. Is that accurate? Let's say I hope it is. And there were eyewitnesses. And remember, at the trial and at the crucifixion, you better say that Jesus was crucified. You better say he screamed at the end, Eli, Eli, lama, my God, why? Sabachthani, you have forsaken me. Then he dies. Now, I know he's quoting a psalm, but he's not quoting the end of the psalm. I think he's a human in all his life. This is me. Don't take it seriously. It's my subjective. All his life, he knew that God was acting through him in a most powerful way. He recognized the wisdom he had was not something that he attained. It was given. And don't forget Einstein when he was pushed. E equals MC squared. Come on, Albert. Tell us how you do it. What was your mathematical formula? Come on, tell us. How did you do it? It was revelation. Ah. The scientists couldn't believe it. What? It was revealed to me. And the same thing with Edison and others. They talk about when you work as hard as you can, speculation and struggle, then I think God can add that little bit that gets you to the final wisdom. So these are some of my thoughts, and I'm open to relaxing. I wish we could see more evidence of God acting in history, but remember, we always see him in the rearview mirror. We can look back, and we won World War II. I can give you 100 reasons why we won battles we shouldn't have. Take, for example, Dunkirk. Unbelievable. No way they could be saved. And it goes back to Hitler. He said, use planes. If he had used the tanks, he wouldn't have lost a tank, and he would have wiped out the whole British army, and that was the heart of our attack forces. Don't people take God and say he was there in the Exodus? Where has he been lately? Let me tell you, you know, Helen Keller, born blind and deaf, but what a genius. You want to leave God out of that? She didn't.
I would like to now discuss the Old Testament pseudepigrapha. I'm going to leave a link in the description below to your Amazon page and other websites in the description so people can go and take a look at them. They're great books. He translated it was 65 books into English. And I'm going to ask you a question about one of them right now. This is about Third Baruch. I've shown you this question in our during our email correspondence. The Greek Third Baruch says that Satanael was the one who tricked Adam into committing the first sin, and he is punished for it, while the Slavonic version of the text calls him Semuel. Does this indicate that the text is combining Satan, Samuel, the serpent, and even Heliel, or Lucifer, in the book of Isaiah as one entity? Or is this Samuel identification with Satan perhaps a later apocryphal development? Or could they originally have been distinct characters based on the dating of the text?
You're referring to three Baruch.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, three Baruch, as you say, we have it in Greek and Slavonic, and they're different traditions. So these are different cultures, and they would have different terms for Satan. And so I think it's just a different way of speaking about Satan. Now, some parts of the world, they would say Satan, and you have to realize that's Satan. In other parts of the world, they would say devil. And, obviously, the devil and Satan are the same person, but very different sound, very different consonants. So I would say that they're different ways of referring to the same person. But now, when you talk about Satan, he appears in the Bible first in Job. He is a lawyer that's testing God in court. And by the time you get to the Apocrypha and Pseudepigrapha and the Dead Sea Scrolls in the New Testament, he has become the one that is thrown out of heaven. Of course, you know from Genesis that he came down with the other evil angels, and they were enticed by women, and they wanted to have sex. I hope that's okay to say that word,
Oh,
S-E-X.
yeah,
Yeah.
it's fine.
So, they were attracted by women, which is very interesting because it may be that sex in too many counters in too many areas is a synonym for evil. But in the Christian tradition, it is a way of loving and honoring and giving birth to the next generation.
So the next one here has to do with the Sibylline oracles. And does this the, when I read this, I was perplexed. Ares being portrayed as the future destroyer of the Roman Empire, well, the future back then, that is, in some sort of messianic apocalyptic prophecy. Does the text seem to view Ares as a destructive messiah of some kind? Or is it perhaps that Ares is being portrayed as an avenger of the Jewish people by destroying the Roman Empire for what they had done to the Jews, despite seemingly portraying him as a destroyer of Israel as well, as the destroyer of Israel as well?
You're very smart. You've read a lot. I'd like to find out where you were trained, because very few people would catch that. The Sibylline oracles cover at least 5 centuries. Very complex. Some of them are Christian, some of them are Jewish, some of them are under the influence of Latin. But you've got it. In one of the Sibylline oracles, 3 and 5, early ones in the list, you have a reference to a mountain. And God is so upset with Rome for what they did to the Jews and to Jerusalem that he's reached down, ripped up the mountain, and smashed Italy. It was written only a few years after Pompeii and Herculaneum were destroyed by Vesuvius. So we have an eyewitness to Vesuvius and the destruction of that area. And I've been there with archaeologists digging and exploring. I think we have found a cross in Herculaneum. And as I studied it and climbed around, I could see that the sun would come in the morning window opposite, and it would shine right on the, it is clearly the form of the cross. There's no question. But the archaeologist said it can't be Christian. It would be the backing of a picture or a backing of something. And I think I am absolutely convinced that in 70, thousands of Christians and Jews were taken from Palestine and from Jerusalem to Rome. We know that. I've studied the inscriptions from Jews. Well, they're right from Palestine. They don't write very well, so they're uneducated, but they left markings. So if some Christians make their way to Pompeii and Herculaneum, that's less than 10 years after the burning of Jerusalem. So, and remember again, where is it? It's in the slave quarters. So I am of the opinion it is a cross, and they probably took the cross. They took the cross into the flames and died in the flames. But there's no question it is a cross. Is it a cross for a picture? Possible. Is it a remains of where a cross was? That to me speaks very clearly. But remember, we often work in the subjunctive, not the indicative. And never in the imperative.
From the days the books of the Old Testament were being written up to the destruction of the Second Temple, apocalyptic thought was quite prevalent in Jewish culture. Do you think the apocalyptic literature evolved into a more destructive and intense thought over time?
After 70, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You have in Second Baruch, which is preserved in Syriac primarily, also in Arabic, and I translated that and studied it. You do have an anti-Roman position, and you even have the idea that God sends his angels and they come in and protect the temple, so the temple was not destroyed. Well, this is an apocalyptic vision. The temple was clearly destroyed, and I have a jar with the burning timbers of the temple. And I got it when I was living there as a young man when I was 28. And there's no question, Jerusalem was burned, the temple was burned. This apocalyptic vision is that, no, the Romans cannot burn the temple because there are two temples, and it goes back a long way, long before Jesus. You have the heavenly temple and you have the earthly temple. And when you're in the earthly temple, you're praying to the heavenly temple. And it talks about the axis mundi, the column that connects heaven and earth. This is all Jewish thought and astrology. I hope that is helpful. Yes, the apocalypses are really more and more after 70 war literature. And they fueled the zealots. And remember, in 70, it's all over. Except for Masada or Masada, which fell in 73 or 74. That depends on your position. And then remember, in 132, Bar Kokhba, who was called Mashiach, the Messiah, he led another rebellion. And after his death, 132 to 135 was the war. You really don't have these kind of apocalypses evermore. But you're right. From 70 to 132, you have apocalypses that are more and more warlike.
Third Baruch often refers to the Old Testament Adam as the first Adam. Does this imply that a Jewish sect had preached some form of a second Adam theology?
We have the Testament of Adam that was collected by the Adamites, maybe, but we know about the Adamites as we know about the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Essenes, the Zealots, the Samaritans. We know about the Baptist groups and the Adamites. There are 24 groups that we have, and I need to publish that because scholars talk about the time when there were four sects. Very confusing. Jesus led a sect, so you're going to leave him out? That's just stupid. The most powerful person, the most prominent person of that time would have been Jesus, at least as we look back. He wasn't an insignificant figure. How many people followed him? In Acts, they say 4,000 people were baptized in one day. Everybody says, I never heard that, or that's impossible. Why is it impossible? How many people saw him crucified? They never asked the question. I would say 50,000. How many people saw him in the temple? I would say maybe 80,000. People say they're never that. Well, you're at Passover. They're coming from Persia. They're coming from Egypt. They're coming from Greece. They're coming from Rome. The Jews are going to the temple, and they're pouring in, and that's why Jesus is there. It's Passover. And how many were there? I think maybe as many as 100,000. And Jesus, you know, turning over the money changers and being powerful and speaking and lecturing every day. I followed John. He was there for 6 months before Passover lecturing. How many people saw him? How many people followed him? How large were the crowds when he entered? Obviously, the Romans were concerned. And remember, Peter had a sword. And Jesus once asked, how many swords do we have? They said, we got two, sir, two, Father, two Rabbi, two Messiah, two Jesus. He says, that's enough. So people say, well, I didn't know they were armed. Well, take time and read the New Testament carefully. Not as devotional. That's fine. Do it. Please read it to find out who you are and what you need. And that salvation is possible, but I'm not preaching now. I'm doing research and asking. Mm-hmm. I try to say things that even a Jew and an atheist would agree with. There were a lot of people that saw Jesus.
Mm. Since 2nd Baruch refers to the destruction of the temple in AD 70, was it written then, immediately, or shortly thereafter the temple was destroyed, or perhaps a bit later after about, say, a year, 2 years, or a little later?
My own research suggests it was written sometime between 80 and 110. You know that it's written after the burning of the temple, and it's clearly before Bar Kokhba, but there aren't the historical pillars that you can use. Mm. What's going on in 92? What's going on in 95? What's going on in 86? There aren't these events. Remember that the whole area has been wiped out, but we now know there were Jews left behind. We are digging and finding evidence of Jews that have inkwells, and they're not far from the walls of Jerusalem, a little north of it. They were putting in a wall, and a road, and north of the wall of Jerusalem, they found Jewish inkwells and evidence of Jewish life. It blew our minds. Remember, archaeology is one of the queens of the sciences. And we have to remember, archaeology doesn't come with a tag. This was held by Jesus. I have a lot of pots here in my home. And I say, the people that held them lived during the time of Jesus in Jerusalem. Mm. Many of them saw Jesus. So when you're touching it, you're touching those that were touched by the master. And, you know, and then people drop their jaws, you know. But I've got to find a home for my antiquities. Maybe the people that are listening. I have antiquities from the time of Abraham up to the time of Constantine, or 1850 BC up to about 400. And I'd like to find a home for them. The seminaries around here just have no money to build a place where they could be protected. And they need to be shown and preserved. So, and I have my library too. I'd like to find a home for it. 20,000 books, many manuscripts.
Hmm. Does 2nd Baruch remind you of the little apocalypse in Mark 13 in any way, as part of a series of apocalyptic texts emerging in the wake of the destruction of the Second Temple of Jerusalem?
Definitely. It's Mark 13, and we know it was written sometime around 70. Some scholars are convinced it was written in 69, knowing that what would happen would probably happen. Others are convinced it was written in 61 or 62 and describes what happened. It talks about those who are in Jerusalem don't go out. I would think that's a pretty stupid comment, actually. I wouldn't tell them to stay there if they're going to build a wall around them. And then you have the famine and then the horror slaughtering. So I dated around 70. You can say, so now second Baruch, it probably was written in Aramaic and preserved in Syriac. They're a kin language. If I talk to you in Aramaic or Syriac, it would sound the same. It's a different script, but it's the Aramaic script is what Hebrew uses today, and the Hebrew script went out of custom about 700, around there, B.C.
Third Enoch says that Metatron is the lesser Yahweh. Does this suggest a Jewish sect existed that believed in two deities, two gods, instead of only one, in some form of Jewish dualistic theology breaking away from Torah orthodoxy?
Well, when you go from second Baruch to third Baruch to one Enoch and then three Enoch, one Enoch was written over 300 years, many, many positions and many, many documents brought together. Now, three Enoch is very late, 200 to 500 from the Common Era. And it does represent a Jewish group that does believe in two powerful beings. So you're on to that. Good for you.
There are some martyrdom tales in the Pseudepigrapha, like the Ascension of Isaiah and the Testament of Job. Did the authors of these books reinterpret martyrdom traditions in order to link them to the apocalyptic events that they wrote about?
The best book is one you left out. It's The Lives and Deaths of the Prophets. It's in the Pseudepigrapha. And what you're talking about, martyr means witness. What does the martyr witness to? That there is another world, there is another king, there is another power, and that what we are seeing as powerful are really not going to be here. You haven't talked to Julius Caesar today, have you? He's been long gone.
Right.
So these powerful people, no matter who they are, Winston Churchill, Albert Einstein, they're gone. We are not eternal in terms of the flesh. I cannot speak about where these people are now, nor where you and I are going to be in 500 years. But we do have a hope, and the hope is based upon a belief, and the belief is based upon some great traditions. But three Enoch is very, very late into the early Middle Ages, and I think it does represent the belief in two gods. Why is two gods necessary? I wish we Christians had not destroyed Satan. All around the world, Christians are saying there's no Satan. Well, how can you explain the Holocaust? How can you explain Hitler? He is the most evil man who ever lived. What about Hussein? What about Gaddafi? These are evil people. You don't tell me there's not a Satan. And, I'm not telling you I believe in a Satan. I'm saying simply, when Christians said this, and Jews, that there's no Satan, we've lost the power that you see in 3 Enoch. Now, I would say that from my point of view, remember, when God created, he either gave the human, Adam and Eve, freedom, or he didn't. Well, if he didn't give them freedom, they were just a projection of God. It was just God saying, you're wonderful, God. It was himself. But if he created Adam and Eve with the ability to say, bug off, buddy, and they did, didn't God know once they gave them freedom that they eventually, some of them, would reject it? What is really beautiful to me is throughout history, there are these people, wonderful people, we call them saints. Joan of Arc. Don't go into that, you know. People are going into it and saying that I don't think she was so admirable. She was wonderful. She died for her faith. And I think the popes are wonderful. I think the preachers are wonderful. They're willing to sacrifice. I hope more of them didn't benefit so much by their preaching. It would be better if we saw preachers sacrificing so much, then we'd know that they really were giving everything they had. And some of them are. When they die, they give all they have to the church. and they've given their life to the church. So we do have centuries of people, men and women, who are, everybody's smart, they could finish that sentence. But there was a martyr in New England, and they said, we know you have a devil. It's the witch trials. Everybody know about the witch trials. And they put a heavy stone on his chest. And they said, admit that you have a devil. And he said, pack it on, buddy. Mm-hmm. And they kept putting one heavy stone on another until he couldn't breathe. But he died. Let's realize, what a trail of martyrs. Are they all fools? Or are they all able to listen? I often say to people when they say, I haven't heard God, I said, well, that's interesting. Can you hear the TV when it's off? No. I said, well, when you turn it on, do you hear it? Oh, very clearly. Well, how many hours a night do you sit there quietly turning on to God, praying and listening? I just think we have lost the art. In the old days, Jesus would go out to the fields and to the mountains and pray, and he would be there all night. One of the articles I never wrote is Socrates. Mm. Socrates was a soldier, and he left the campfire, and he wandered out to the seashore. And a soldier followed him and kept behind a dune, and he saw Socrates stand there at attention all night long. And when the sun came up, he walked back to the camp. What are we talking about? What is this power of meditation? And where does revelation come from? Obviously, it cannot come from us. But are we making ourselves receptive and open? Are we listening? Are we becoming quiet?
The Testament of Job, Joseph, and Asenath, and the New Testament, and the treatment of Moses, both expand the narratives of the Old Testament's Job and Moses. Could it be that some material in both texts go back to earlier sources that we don't have, or is it too difficult to tell? And I'm asking this question in terms of, like, are there historical data in them or not? Reliable, that is.
You are confronting the claim that the Apocrypha, Pseudepigrapha, and other writings from the time of Jesus and Hillel and Joanna and Ben Zakkai and Paul are just new creations. They don't have traditions. The authors are convinced that they are preserving traditions that are very old. Now remember, Socrates wrote nothing. Jesus wrote nothing. In antiquity, the great minds say, don't write it down because you can't control it. And scholars say to me today, you know, oral tradition is fluid, but when you write something, it's not fluid. I said, have you ever studied a manuscript? The top text expert in America said, never did. I said, how many manuscripts have you studied? None. I study the books. There is hardly any manuscript I've studied that has corrections in the top of the line, in the margin. So it's not so set. It's fluid. It's being changed. And you have scribes changing words. And then when they copy this to another manuscript, they're changing. So a written script is not set. Now, when we talk about the oral, you stand up in the church and say, our parent, hallowed be thy name. They will say, no, it's our father. Pater hemon hoen toi seranos, our father who art in heaven. So you have oral tradition, and that controls tradition. People are saying, be careful. Now, I work on the Syriac New Testament in St. Catherine's, and it has the Lord's Prayer in a much better fashion than we have in Greek or German or any language, English. And I can't go into that now because it would demand knowing Syriac, but it has the Lord's Prayer in the way that Jesus meant it. He did not say, lead us not into temptation. God doesn't lead us into temptation. What a stupid idea. It's the Syriac and the Aramaic. Jesus spoke, oh God, do not allow us to be led into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. So you have parallelismus, memorum, synonymous. The same thought is in two different lines. Do not allow us to be led. God protects you from being led. Who is leading you into temptation? But protect us from the evil one. So that was the original of the Lord's Prayer.
Would you like to expand on that at some point in another episode?
I think this has gone well, and listen to your audience, and they say, don't ever have him on again. We should listen to that.
Yeah, you were saying earlier about the Syriac and the prayer, and that you didn't want to get in too deep into that right now in this episode. I was just asking if at some point, if you wouldn't mind, in a future episode, to get into that. That's
If you think a future episode and your audience would like that.
Oh, yeah. I think I want to do future episodes.
Heard enough from me.
Do the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Old Testament Pseudepigrapha share in common an apocalyptic future in which the Gentile enemies of Israel would be defeated, given what it says in the Sibylline oracles?
The most important document among the Dead Sea Scrolls that speak to that is the War Scroll, the Milchama. And in the Milchama, the Beni-Or, the Sons of Light, the Essenes, not one of them die in the war. Not one of them. So obviously, God is going to conquer. He's invincible. He's absolutely powerful. And those who fight with him will not die, but live forever. So that's the War Scroll. And when you talk about the Pseudepigrapha, you're talking about more than a millennium of compositions. So we don't want to say that they're saying the same thing. Even the same author, maybe. Remember, you have heard say, be consistent. I thought it's better to say, be representative of what you're seeing. And when you see something different, you don't say the same thing. I've asked my students at Duke and Princeton, are you want to be consistent? Oh, yes, sir. Okay. Every time I ask you a question, say yes, because that would be consistent, wouldn't it? They said, oh, yeah, that's consistent. All right. Can you hear me? Yes. Are you all going to flunk? They didn't answer. Mm. They couldn't say yes. They want to be consistent. So if the question changes, if the data changes, the answer must change. I could put it this way. The good scholar, the brilliant scholar, is always changing and growing. Why? Because the database is changing. Our methodology is changing. Name one method used today in science, in sociology, in economics that we are not using in archaeology. Tell me about it. We'll start using it.
What led scholars to conclude that Pseudo-Philo was not written by Philo of Alexandria?
We have many, many books from Philo. I have them on the shelf here. I think, 10 volumes. I don't go around memorizing how many volumes, but around 10 volumes. If someone said they're 9 or something, 12 or 30. A lot of volumes by Philo, pointed. Many, many volumes. So we know what Philo thinks. Pseudo-Philo is not about that at all. And it was named in the early Middle Ages, and we've written on why it was called Philo. Basically, the author wanted to associate it with Philo, and then we called it Pseudo-Philo, but it's not related to Philo. It really is talking about the history of the Jews. Mm. Philo had no interest in that.
All right. Well, I think we can stop here until then. We're going to get into a future episode at some point where I would like to expand with you next time on the I would like to have you expand on the archaeology and getting deeper into the Talpiot tomb and the James ossuary as we plan during this discussion.
Well, if you do the James ossuary, I would want maybe James Tabor to be involved.
Sure.
He's a professor at Charlotte, and he's been there with me many, many years working and he's been very much involved, and he and I have different positions. So, but we're good friends. And when I tell him you're just not understanding, he will come back with maybe you're not understanding. So people have to understand that scholars debate and argue.
I have interviewed him earlier this year.
Oh, good.
I would definitely like to arrange you and him to come on together.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, okay. Both of us together. Tell him I agreed.
Okay. Hello viewers, thanks for watching this video from the History Valley YouTube channel. Please don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell, and if any of you wish to further support this channel, please consider checking out this channel's Patreon page and becoming a patron, and or donate through PayPal or through Super Chat during a live stream. Thank you.